Good evening, everybody. Wish you all a very, very, very happy April Fool's Day. And today, we all are here to discuss among ourselves, why should we not celebrate April Fool just on the April Fool's Day, but we should celebrate it for the whole day. There are many reasons for it to be happening. And to explain that, we are having a great bulldozer of a personality among us.
When is it going to move?
A bulldozer who has shattered many walls, many boundaries in Goa. Dr. Claude Alvares. Please give him a big hand. So now Dr. Claude, our Claude Bob will be explaining us why the day of April Fool is relevant to Goa and Goan people all of the year, throughout the year, 365 days a year. Claude Bob.
When Nilankur just asked me to come on April Fool's Day, I said, that's a good joke. Nobody's going to take me seriously and nobody's going to come because nobody comes on any message on April Fool's Day. Now I find that you people can't take a joke. And therefore I am now under compulsion to entertain you. Because you can't say anything serious on April Fool's Day. So I was trying to figure out how to take you all for a ride. And whether the things that I want to say today will make some sense. We are, you know, actually in a very opportune moment to discuss what is happening in Goa on April Fool's Day. Because now we have the elections announced. The last time we had elections in 2017, we voted for one party and we got another party. Now this time, whatever party you vote for is going to be the same party. You can vote for the Congress, those guys will bolt and join the BJP. And you vote for Aam Aadmi Party and they will bolt and join the BJP. And you go for the Congress and they will do the same thing. Because nobody is going to be able to resist these suitcases of Mr. Amit Shah. So, this whole election is going to be a joke. Because the citizens really don't know what to do in these circumstances. We have reached the lowest level of our democratic system in Goa. Because Goa has been the leader for this. You know? Goa has been the leader in showing politicians how to defeat the anti-defection law. And now they have taken it to a new level, which is whoever has voted, we will still rule. Mr. Amit Shah, as a matter of fact, said that we are going to be here for the next 50 years. I don't know whether he is going to be there physically for the next 50 years, but he said we are going to be there for the next 50 years, which means that whatever government comes into power anywhere, it will be a BJP government. So this is our dispensation. This is the sort of situation in which we are going to be looking at it. So in a sense, it's a very appropriate thing because it's a very unreal thing because we are the world's largest democracy and yet being the world's largest democracy and duly exercising our vote, we still don't get what we want. We get something else, which somebody else has planned for us and which we have got to accept whether we like it or not. So I don't want to be very defeatist in this because at least there are many things that are happening in Goa where a lot of people are doing things which indicates that they are not defeatist at all. I think if you look at Goa as a whole, people sometimes come to visit me, TV crews and all sorts of other types of people come to waste my time. And they say that, you know, what's happening in the state of Goa? I said, there are hundreds of things happening in the state of Goa. There's not one village in Goa where there's no protest going on. There's no agitation going on. There's no, you know, rumpus in the Gram Sabha over something that's happening there. And there's no dharna or some street protest or something. It's a, if you look at the whole country, you think the whole country was dead compared to what's happening in Goa and the type of vitality that's there in Goan villages. So there are a lot of people who genuinely feel that things can change. The thing is whether we feel that we are living in a fool's paradise, whether somebody is playing a massive prank on us, and whether we should continue with what we do. Now, I have always been a despairing optimist. I said that generally, whatever has to happen, will happen. And whatever you have to do, you do. You don't do something, because if you do it, something may not happen. I don't want to keep this exchange only to what is happening in the state of Goa. And I thought that I'd also broad-base whatever I want to share with you today. It's what's happening in the country and what's happening in the world at large. Where the general principle is, keep continue taking people for a ride. And some of them are quite expensive rides. Vandana Shiva was speaking the other day, she's written a new book called Oneness versus the 1%. A very strange title, Oneness versus the 1%. And she talks about oneness in the sense that we are a whole family across the planet, that's why we are one. You may be blacks, you may be whites, you may be whatever it is, but we're all living on the same planet, so we're all one. But now for the first time we feel that this oneness has to fight against this 1%. And who is this 1%? She's written a very interesting book with her son. Her son was living here in Vere for at least the last 2 years, doing all the research for the book. And when we had gone out to have a meal, he was explaining to us, and we couldn't believe what he was saying. He was saying that he had done whatever research he had done, wherever he had gone to on the internet, to look at who owns things, who has got the maximum amount of political control over things that are happening in all the economies of the planet. He said he came across the same five names. Whatever the activity, whatever the corporation, whichever the country, you would find the same people parked there in some way or the other. And Vandana gives these very astonishing figures, which I have copied laboriously for your edification today. And I was myself amazed. She said, look at what's happening. Because we are all given the illusion that this planet is run by educated folk who know where it is heading. She said that in 210, the world had 388 billionaires whose total property, whose total ownership was equivalent to 50% of the population of the planet. There was just 388 billionaires in 210. Then she said in 2011 it became 177 billionaires. In 2012, it became 159 billionaires. 2013, it became 92 billionaires. 2014, it came down further to 80 billionaires. 2016, it came down to 62 billionaires. 2017, it came down to 8 billionaires. And last year, it is five billionaires, who between themselves own more than 50% of the population of this planet. Now, it's very interesting that these guys, their money keeps on multiplying He found out how were they doing this. He said they were shareholders in six of the largest investment firms in the world. Six of the largest investment firms. And these firms were really not even in existence in 2008. In 2008, everybody knows the prime crisis. The whole economy of the United States collapsed. A huge amount of banks would have gone into debt, but for the fact that they were able to loot all the earnings of the middle class and the upper middle class and hand them over back to see that those banks could continue. The banks were never punished. A whole lot of people, the majority of the population of the United States, got cleaned out. And as a result of it, the investment bankers became richer. And the shares in these companies were owned by these guys. Now, have you ever heard the names of these companies? BlackRock. You heard of BlackRock? BlackRock is an investment firm, number one. They manage the assets of all these shareholders. The second one is Vanguard. I didn't know these names till I heard Vandana. Then there was UBS. Now, their asset, the total amount of asset they control, BlackRock is today worth $6 trillion. Vanguard is $5 trillion. UBS is $3 trillion. State Street Global Advisors is $2.8 trillion. Fidelity Investments is $2.4 trillion, and Alliance is $2.2 trillion. Four of these are American companies. One is a Swiss company. One is a German company. These companies are growing so fast that they are going to own everything in a very short while. There's nothing going to be left. They will be into every nook and corner of the globe. They will be controlling your lives far more effectively than Mr. Modi or even the Pope. This is the type of enormous power that is passed into the world. This has happened from 2010 to 2018 in the sphere of just 8 years. These are actors who are really not there on the scene in 2008 or 2009. But today, they straddle the planet with the largest amount of resources, and they service the billionaires of the planet. And the billionaires of the planet now are dictating terms in health, Medicare, Bill Gates, what seeds are to be planted in your fields, so that on one side you feel that we are, after all, in control. But in very, very important details, the control has already gone above our hands. If you look at the seed business, which we are very much concerned for so many years, it's now in the hands of just three corporations. That is Monsanto and Bayer, and Chem, Syngenta and Chem, China. And the third is Dow Chemicals, which has merged with DuPont. These three corporations are known over the world as the three poison chemicals, chemical companies, because their job is only to produce poisons, from Agent Orange to whatever poisons this planet has been getting in terms of the chemicals that we have been unloosening on the planet, on people, on wildlife, on bees and everything. These are the three corporations. They're called poison corporations. They have now bought into the seed trade, and now they hold practically the patents and the maximum seed supplies that are used by farmers all over the world. So they can take out any seed, just like they have done with cotton. They introduced BT cotton in India. Today, 95% of cotton in India is BT cotton, owned by Monsanto, or by an agent of Monsanto, which is Mayco, which is a company located in Maharashtra. So you want to buy organic cotton, well, you'll not be able to get it. You'll have to search for it, you'll have to, organize an expedition for it or something, or you'll probably try to find some farmers who are growing it somewhere. But by and large, all the cotton that we are wearing today, which is coming out from all the mills or even from the Khadi centers, Gandhi's Khadi handmade, hand-spun Khadi center. All this cotton is genetically engineered cotton. This is a great achievement, but it's a sign of what is going to happen in our time. Now, the only successful story about India is they tried to do the same thing for Brinjal, and they failed. Why did they fail? Again, because this society peculiarly has got some mechanisms by which it is able to revolt and push the political system to beware of certain things, to halt certain decisions and so on. It's the only country in the world, I think, where you can enforce popular decisions from time to time. It's very difficult in most other countries, from Iran to the United States. But in India, there are things that are still possible, the spaces are still open. Our only worry is that will those spaces close even while we believe that we are open? We feel that we are open, but most of us have no idea about the networks that are emerging on the international scene, which will undermine everything, to which our GST introduction is linked, and most of the other things, developments that are coming, are linked. So this is in terms of the as I said, the facade. You feel that sometimes you are being taken for a ride. Because on the one hand, you feel that everything is open, you go for international conferences, seminars, you speak freely, and so on. But you know, when you look at this, that the accumulation of wealth with people who don't necessarily have any great capacity to handle it. It's not that, see, when wealth is with a large number of people, then a large number of people have the wisdom to handle it properly. But if you put wealth in the hands of five or six people, these five or six people, how do they come up? Bill Gates comes up because he purchases a basic program for $50,000 and then after that he becomes the richest man in the world. He is there as the richest man in the world for some time, but then now he is knocked down by the other guys who are coming fast and taking over whatever position he had. But if you look at them as characters, as with their education, with their capabilities, with their expertise, with what they were really good at, they're good human beings, you realize that inside they are just as good as anybody else. They were as lucky as anybody, probably luckier than other people, and probably able to perfect the art of exploitation to such an extent that they could do things that normally other people would hesitate to do. And that's why they have landed up in that particular position, very ruthless position of occupying these positions, because these positions are not handed over to you. There's a lot of manipulation involved, there are a lot of fights involved, there are a lot of conflicts involved. But ultimately, you reach that limit, and then you say, oh, I'm Bill Gates, now everybody bows before me. If I go to India, the Prime Minister gives me an appointment. If I go to Tamil Nadu, I get an appointment with this. And everybody looks, and all the youngsters of the world, they look at Bill Gates, and they look at all these guys, and they say, wow, this is something that I hope I can participate in some way, someday. And that's why you get this enormous armies of suckers getting into the system. On the one hand, if you look at it, step aside and look at it, it's nothing but a huge global slave labor camp. Slave labor, wherever you go, whether you are in New York or in Germany or in Indonesia or in Bangladesh or whatever it is, only the nature of the slave trade changes. In Bangladesh, there will be 10,000 people doing textiles for the rest of the world. But other places, they may be doing something. India has supplied the new type of indentured labor, which is, you know, what we call software. We're all in some way or the other, we are doing only something which is not part of what we wanted to do. It came as a big wave, we have looked at it, and now we are all fighting more. All of us want to be Bill Gates. All of us want to be Warren Buffett. All of us want to somehow, get into that stream, because that unimaginable riches that are available to these people is so awesome that it can flash and dazzle anybody. But it's an unrealistic assumption. First of all, I want to ask, why are we not able to take these six people and put them somewhere in some lunatic asylum and take away all their money? Because we'll have a huge amount of wealth available for the rest of the world. Six people only you can't defeat. We are a population of 3 billion people. Can't we do something with these guys? But what are they doing with this money? They don't understand it. They are, you know, now they say, oh, we'll give half of it here, we'll give half of it there, whatever it is. But there's no giving half. Nobody gives half freely. It's all tied up to all sorts of strings. We just don't understand why is the world being held to ransom by this, not just by these 6 people or 5 people, but by the unrealistic dreams that they are putting forward to millions of youngsters all over the world who, you know, get completely distorted by what they want to do in life. And somebody may want to be a good musician or a good dancer or a practical joker or who know what, but in the end, finally, all of them are becoming computer specialists or, you know, some software this or that or whatever, they're all going in that particular direction. And you say, look, if all of you are going to go in this direction of, you know, the engineering and computer and this, that and all, who's going to look after the birds? And who's going to look after the rivers? And who's going to look after the seeds of the earth? Who's going to look after the air? You've been to Delhi, you know, in November? Even Bill Gates, can he survive in Delhi? You've been to Delhi? You've seen I don't go to Delhi now from November right up to my, I just went there last week after everything was settled down. But it's a hazard to go to a city like that. It's a capital city, for heaven's sake, of this country. And being the capital city, this is the sort of a lead that they are giving all of us and how we are all going in the same direction. Not that Goa doesn't, Goa, the PM 2.5 and PM 10, levels in Panjim are getting close to Delhi at some time on the year. They have measured them. So we are chasing after them. So who is the bigger fool? At some stage do we say that no, this is not the way we go, and Goa doesn't have to go that way, because if you look at it in a realistic way, the whole country of 1.3 billion people wants to come and visit Goa. Why do they want to come and visit Goa? Because of what the Goans have created. And now the Goans are either going to London or they are trying to say, no, what we did is no good for us because maybe we are all fools. Anybody who doesn't do anything nowadays, which is like the mainstream, is a bloody fool. You don't want to go to school, you're a fool. You don't want to, go to college, you're a fool. You don't want a job, you're a fool. Even if the job which you're offering to the guy is to either murder some human beings or murder the environment, but you'll be a fool if you don't take up the job. Everybody must have a job. Oh, who said that? Who made this requirement that everybody had to have a job? And why should anybody who's a free person want to subject himself to some other person's useless project? Maybe useful for him, making profits for him and making him more economically powerful. But what has it got to do with me? And why should I spend 50, 60 years of my life being so foolish as to say, forget it, I'm closing down my life, closing down the department, closing down my mind, closing down my senses, closing down everything and following that guy? The most classic, I sometimes think that some of these great guys whom we have in the past, we don't read too much anymore. The most powerful imagery of people whom you would think were foolish, but who ultimately ended up killing themselves and in a situation which none of us would want to be in, was what happened with the Nazis. It's the most macabre image that has ever been created by none other than Ivan Illich, one of our great writers on de-schooling society. And Illich says, this is what the modern system is meant to do to you. It will give you an aspiration. It will give you a hope. It will trust. You will trust in it. And when it's doing so, it'll kill you. And he used as a graphic example what happened in Nazi Germany when the Jews were first of all incarcerated, kept in horrible buildings, not allowed to have a bath for weeks on end, and finally when they were all desperate and willing to do anything but to have a bloody bath, they said, yes, now you can go and have a bath. And then they were all given a piece of soap and made to stand up in line, and they went right up to the places where they could have a bath, and then the showers were turned on. And you know what came out from the showers? The gas that killed them all. That is the nature of our aspiration today. We all, in a certain sense, now feel deprived. And we feel so deprived that we feel that every day something or the other must come. And finally, we are willing to get into the most obnoxious situations because we say finally, oh, finally some relief is going to come. And then we get butchered. I see endless number of films nowadays. Yesterday I saw this film, that Rami Malek film, this Bohemian Rhapsody film. And you look at this Bohemian Rhapsody film and you find, you know, in the end, they are all dissatisfied people. In the end, main person dies of HIV, the singer dies of HIV. So many other movies, I have not seen any movie where people, particularly singers, drama, artists who get into all this commercial filmmaking, music making, in the end ending up as very unhappy individuals, dying or going to seed, and in the end coming out as total wrecks. But once you get like a moth, once you get into that situation, there is no chance for you. Now, who is the fool? I once went to Ahmedabad to participate in a Diksha. As a matter of fact, just as an aside, my very good close friend, Jain Monk, who died just on the 24th, was a young boy, he was younger than me, the son of a diamond merchant. And when he became a monk, it was he came on the cover of India Today at that time. I think it was maybe 15, 20 years ago. And according to the Diksha ceremony, there is a big procession the previous evening before you get your vows as a monk. And it happens even now. I mean, if you go to most of these places in Gujarat, there's still people taking dikshas, young people, rich people, poor people, men, women, whatever. That's to become monks, Jain monks. A very, very severe and austere type of life. It's very difficult. I've interacted with them so many times that I don't know whether I could even manage to even, 5% of the type of rigor which they bring to their lives in terms of their beliefs. And this guy was the son of a diamond merchant, so he had to distribute his patrimony to the rest of the population, to the rest of society, because that's the act of renunciation. You can't say, I'm going to renounce everything and I give it to my brothers and sisters. That's not accepted in the tradition. And in the tradition, the parents are so happy that their child is becoming a monk that they all put in their share also and give it to him. And the most joyous ceremony that you can have is on the day when they move in a chariot to the streets of either Ahmedabad or, Bhavnagar or wherever the dikshas take place. And you can see the joy on their face because they've got all these, in his case, there were diamonds in his hand. In other cases, they have notes, they have silver pots, they have all coins and they have everything. And there's this guy who is going to become a monk and he's got all these things in his hand and he's throwing them to the public. And if you are a bystander and standing aside and watching it, then you can see one man, one fool is being liberated, but a million other fools are being created in this place. Because as he is throwing the diamonds and as he is throwing the money, there is a huge scramble of people trying to get those notes and those gold coins and the diamonds and all that sort of thing. And he is there and he's completely free because He's got rid of the whole thing. Now he's himself. He's got rid of all these deceptions. All these things that were put into his head. And now he's a free man. And that is the Diksha ceremony that I saw. Afterwards I went for several of them because they're very moving and very powerful. And they also change you in a very fundamental way. After that you really didn't bother anymore about, you know, about these things, about career, about promotion, about being a great man, about this, about that, whatever, because you saw in real life this Mahabharat taking place, where one man took everything that he had in his pockets and his patrimony and his whatever was due to him from the family and was just throwing it. And then that riveting sensation of seeing those thousands of people, because it's the Diksha, the word goes around, there's Diksha, we are going to get something. And people going there and clamoring and crowds and fighting with each other for the coins and so on. After you see a Diksha ceremony, you'll be a changed person for the rest of your life. You must go sometimes to Gujarat to be part of them. They are all open open ceremony. They always invite people to come. They look after your food. They share your food. You can eat as much as you want. They are all organic in many ways. They don't, you know, because they are Jains, they don't use electrical power. They don't use any of these things. They use hand-drawn vehicles and they will serve all the elaborate, you know, recipes. I remember eating one meal which had about something like 72 different recipes. I mean, you couldn't eat. I mean, it was just, that you tasted a little bit. But everything was done with such care and attention that they looked on their guests as something people had come to honor them. But it was a very moving ceremony. But that was when I realized the real significance of foolishness and of being entrapped and of being stuck now. And you see different layers, whether it's at the level of Goa or the level of the country or the level of our politicians or even at the level of the international economy, how you can get entrapped and participate in it and entrap other people also in your turn, or how you can step aside and how you can look at these things and how you can possibly leverage them to some advantage. Now in Goa, as I said, the situation has been extremely abnormal. We have, you would say, everybody would say Goa, Goa. When you come into a spice jet flight in Delhi or into an Indigo airline, it is like you are the only Goan on the flight. And there's all these people who think that they are going to end up in some paradise. You know, the whole world has spoken about it. And there's only Goa, Goa, Goa. And they're all discussing. And they pay whatever, 2,000, 3,000 rupees to the hostesses for whatever meals. Because now they are in a fantasy. And then they come here and they land here. Now, what happens here afterwards, forget it. I don't. But it's an atmosphere that is created, that this is a wondrous place. The people are all highly educated, maybe not as highly educated as Kerala, but nearly equally highly educated. And therefore, it must be having wonderful governance. It must be having an extraordinary set of political leaders. It must be having extraordinary, you know, people all down, highly, you know, people who know how to manage their affairs. Because how do they keep this place so beautiful? Every other place has destroyed their Goas. I tried to examine why people were coming to Goa. I remember in Bangalore, when I was living there in the 50s and 60s, there were 15 Goas in Bangalore. It was an air-conditioned city. You went to Hyderabad, it's the same thing. You went to all the major cities, from Madras, so all these places, each one had its own beauty, and people didn't want to go out because there was no need to go out. But once Bangalore destroys all their Goas, then where do people have to go? Why are people buying property in Goa from Delhi? It's because they have already abandoned Delhi. But sometimes I think we have to solve the pollution problem of Delhi in order to save Goa from the real estate that it's got in. So you would think, this is an extraordinary population. They don't have any worries on their face. They're all happy-go-lucky. They're all the time ready to talk to you. They're the original affluent class. Nowadays, even if you're the chief executive officer of a General Motors or whatever company, the main thing you feel is, as a chief executive officer, is that you don't have time. You have to apportion it to as many people. You require a team of time managers who will say what is good for the company, what is good for you, what is your quality time, what not. In Goa, there was never such distinction. Everybody had 100% quality time. You could sit and talk to people. People would talk to you. People would address you wherever you go. And that was the atmosphere of Goa. Because that is why what we felt was remarkable. That the people here had made peace with themselves. They were not willing to compromise themselves like the people in other parts of the world, who would chew themselves to the bone, get into a heart bypass by the time that they are 35, and still believe that they have made it in the rest of the world. No, here people were very relaxed. They knew what time they had to sleep. They would sleep in the afternoon. They would, you know, they had time. That real quality of a rich man is that he has got the time to have a conversation. If he doesn't have that time, he is a poor guy, not worth even dealing with. Because the most precious thing he doesn't have. They're like cooking. If you can't eat freshly cooked food and you're condemned most of your life, like I've seen people in Holland and people in US and people are and addicted to the same type of industrialized, manufactured, processed foods, then there's something wrong. This is the place where you could, and this is not just in Goa, but also in the rest of the country, where people appreciate that you take time out to eat your food. There, they become so much part of the industrial mega machine that eating food is also part of the business of productivity and keeping the machine going. So there's no pleasure in food. Now, what pleasure can you get by eating these oily Mac burgers or this Kentucky Fried Chicken, which looks like voodoo? What pleasure can you get? When you compare it with, you know, chicken cooked Malay style or Pakistani style or South Indian style or Bengali style with mustard or with coconut style or this or whatever. People used to always ask me, you eat fish curry rice every day, you're most boring. I said, Baba, we eat fish curry rice, but our curries, we have 365 curries. Please try and understand it. We have pink colored curries, we have yellow colored curries, we have red colored curries, we have whatever it is, but we have enough curries to keep the diversity going for a full year. If you don't understand that, you're not understood. What is the life of a person. This Goa also got taken for a ride. In a most remarkable way, I mean, in the sense that we never thought that we would end up in a situation like this. Today, we are at the top of the garbage heap. Forget about literal garbage, I mean, that, you know, Dean and all these people are sitting on in Assagao. But we are right now, today, we are the most indebted state in the country. We have a debt of 20,000 crore. It was 6,000 crore when Manohar Parrikar took over. So each Goan, you know, owes about 60 to 70,000 rupees when the time the day is born, you have to give him an indebted, you can't give him a credit certificate, you have to give him a debit certificate. We are rich, suppose we are a rich state. But this is our halat. This is where we have landed. The most indebted state in the Indian Union. Now you think that, well, what is the status of the Indian Union? Then you say maybe, well, it's not that bad when you consider that the Indian Union itself is in a state of debt. And the latest figure is that we are in debt to the tune of 82 lakh crore. 82 lakh crore is the debt of the Indian government. It's gone up by 50 lakh crore since Modi took over. So how much of the money has gone to Adani, I don't know. But that is the exponential jump in the last 4 years. We have gone from a debt of something like 45 you know, lakh crore to now 82 lakh crore. Now here, please note, we may be ripping ourselves, but now there's an additional dimension. We are ripping the next generation as well. It's a very good model. We are saying, we are screwing ourselves, no doubt, but in the bargain, why don't we screw them also? This is the reason why Rahul Basu did not come today, because he had somebody died in Kolkata. He had to go there. But he has been working on this permanent fund. The whole basis of the permanent fund is only about how to look after the next generation. But anyway, that apart, right now, if you go to look at the US economy, India is 82 lakh crore. US economy figure even more bizarre. They are actually to the tune of 222 trillion US dollars. Now, when Alan Greenspan, who is the chairman there, is like the chancellor of the exchequer there, and he was asked, what do we do about this situation? He said, see, we print dollars. So there's no fear that we will ever default on anything. So though they are $222 trillion, it means they are actually bankrupt. Because there's no way they can pay that amount back. Nobody can pay that amount back. It's just bankrupt. It's practically about 200% of their GDP. So even if the entire, all the goods and processes and services of the US economy for 2 years was given over to this to pay back this debt, they would still be in debt after 2 years. This is the extent of indebtedness of the US. So they have ripped off, forget about the next generation, they have ripped off several generations in the process. Now, I can't imagine being a fool and not even being born. I'm not even born, but I've already been ripped off by my parents. My parents who took me to school and who put me and said, study hard, because if you study hard, you'll get a good job and you'll be accommodated, you'll get a car, you'll get a flat, you'll live in a decent neighborhood and you'll be in a gated community and you can, if you want, you can migrate. There are people who are migrating from an economy which is not yet bankrupt to a fully bankrupt economy. Now, what do you mean about, what do you say about this? And there's a drove of people going to the fully bankrupt economy from the people who are less bankrupt. It's not serious matter. You laugh at it, but I mean, we can only laugh at it in this sense. Because it's gone beyond. Somebody said, whom does the US owe this 222 million trillion US dollars? I mean, somebody has to be given a dividend, no? Somebody has to get the interest on it. And one of their economists has come out with a theory that there's nobody on earth we owe this money to. So obviously, this planet is under the control of some people from outside the planet, because we have to pay somebody the money. It can't be that we are in this sort of a situation where we don't know whom we have to pay. But we are already spending. And we are spending and put ourselves in such enormous debt that our children can't get out of it at all. And these debts are being created not because people want them or ask for them or whatever it is. You take a case like Goa, they created a debt, for example, of 146 crores for putting up a garbage plant in Dean's neighborhood. They said that we'll run this garbage plant for 10 years, you pay us 30 crore every year, that will balance off our 300 crores, 146 crore 10 years will become 300 crores, you pay us 30 crores every year, the government accepted, and we have a plant which has failed in just 1.5 to 2 years, not able to meet anything. And the plant, what it does today is, they just collect all the waste, compact it, put it into bales and send it for burning. 40% of the waste from Assagao modern, the most modern plant in the country, which was meant to deal with unsegregated waste, most foolish idea, is going for burning in cement plants. And every truck that is sent from here to Karnataka to the cement mill costs the Goan government and the public of Goa 22,000 rupees, every truck. And there are hundreds of trucks that leave Goa to take our waste material for burning in another state, because we don't know how to handle it despite our plan. Now, you would think that that was not bad enough. Now they're putting up another 146 crore plant in Kakora, in South Goa. But they're saying that it can't be 146 crore now, because now we have the times have passed. It is 3 years, so that plant is going to cost 170 crores. Then after they said we are going to put up one more plant of this, but we put it up at Bangini, where we've been trying to put up a plant for the last 10 years and not succeeded, but maybe we'll succeed. But then we'll put up a plant there for another 150, 60 crores. And everywhere we'll be paying out 30, 40 crores per annum, and we don't have that type of money. We don't have money to pay even the salaries of the people in the government. Every year, the government would issue a circular in the month of April saying that there's a ban on further dispersal of funds. This used to happen 10 years ago. Last year, the government issued this order in the month of April itself. That means the financial year began in April, and the government issued an order to all the departments saying that no further expenditure will be permitted this season because there is no money. Then this guy gets up and says, we'll put up the Mandavi Bridge. Now the Mandavi Bridge cost 403 crores. So Mr. Parikar had just become Chief Minister and Mr. Modi had just become Prime Minister. So Mr. Parikar said, Mr. Modi will pay for it. So we will call Mr. Modi to inaugurate the bridge, and while he's inaugurating him, we'll tell him, why don't you pay for a bridge as well? When he did it, Mr. Modi came as he is, as he's known to be, he came, he inaugurated the bridge. And when he was told to pay for the bridge, he said, my foot. So what Mr. Marikar had to do? He had to go to NABARD to get a bank loan, because no commercial bank would give him a loan. Now he went to NABARD. Now NABARD grants loans for farmers. They give loans for farmers. On the one hand, there are lakhs of farmers dying every year because they are not able to make ends meet. But NABARD entertains a loan for 460 crores to the Goa government to build the Mandavi Bridge in a city which is not entitled to build at all, not entitled to finance at all. Now, if you don't believe me, go to the NABARD website and you'll find that all the projects which they have listed in Goa are there, except the Mandavi Bridge. The biggest project of theirs, 460 crores, is not listed on their website. Because it is illegal financing, they have done it. Mm-hmm. Now what happens to us is that we have to pay this loan over the next 10 years. So 460 crores will become 560 crores. It reached 900 crores the moment NABARD came into the picture. So now the bridge was worth 900 crores. So we have to pay, this society which doesn't have money, has to pay 900 crores. Now GSIDC, which constructs the bridge, which got the, you know, which did all the contracting, their profit margin last year was 7 crores. Now they have to pay 40 crores on the Mandavi Bridge as their payment. Their total profit was 7 crores. Now what will they do? So the only thing is have more projects. So in order to get that much money, they will now put up bridges and roads and bypasses in everywhere so that this place looks like a complete mirage, you know, where we won't know whether we are coming or whether we are going, whether if we turn the corner we land this way or that way, on which village we'll land up, because you'll have so much of concrete and construction, because these menaces have got to raise the money to pay these debts. And when we are dead, in another 10 years from now, well, our kids, all these youngsters, Rahul and Kavya and all these people, will be paying these bills. For whom? For the Mandavi Bridge. We ask them, why are you building the Mandavi Bridge? This is another April Fool joke on you. They said, we are building it to remove the congestion in Panjim City. So if you want to go into Panjim city, you have to land up in some other portion, because the bridge is not meant for Panjim city. You want to go into Panjim city, don't get on the bridge. You go through some other way down. It looks like an illegal way, but it's not a legal way to get into Panjim. Because if you get into Porvari, you land up in Merses. It's good to go for halwa restaurant, but it's not good for you to enter Panjim city. And the whole design is based on that. Same thing like the garbage plant. The whole garbage plant was approved on the ground that there was a big garbage dump of 55,000 tons lying there for the last 15-20 years, which had completely demolished the Salmona Springs. So they said, no, they called Neeri. Neeri got paid 10 lakhs. They said, no, this must be done. If the garbage plant comes, they will remove this first as a first charge on the operation of the plant. It is now more than 3 years. The garbage dump is there. It has become bigger. Now, we are all educated folk. And you can all see this happening. But somehow, the links are broken between what we can do to stop this menace. It's not that it can't be done. You think that only a fool, sorry for April Fool, but you think that only a fool would have taken up a challenge to block the Mopa airport. And yet two guys did it. One guy is from Mopa itself. He's from the village there. He doesn't have a mobile phone. He doesn't have, he doesn't even have a Facebook page. He's a guy who lost his entire house there in the Mopa thing. And he fought. And the other guys were in Margao. Anybody would say, you guys in Margao, what are you fighting something in Padne? But they got together. They prosecuted the matter. Went to the NGT, lost the case to NGT, prosecuted the matter before the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court has come out in the first time in a judgment, the last paragraph, where they are devoted to environmental activists and their role. And how this is an important thing that has to be done if you believe in environment law. And they have stopped it. They have done a monkey wrenching act, they call it a monkey wrenching act. What is the monkey wrenching act? What the workers did in Europe in the 18th century, when they were not, the corporates were not willing to listen to them. They would throw their wrench in the works and bring the whole machine to a halt. So that's what they have done in the case of Mopa. They put a monkey wrench inside. The project is halted. Now till the people see sense, and till they realize that you can't construct an airport without following environment norms, that will not compromise the next generations as well, the environment, the forest, the birds, everything, the water sources and all. Till you have the sense to do a project that should be done in a particular way, you are going to be stopped. Now we are paying 50 lakh a day, that's what the GMR is saying, we are paying 50 lakh a day as punishment for being stopped. That's half a crore every day. I don't know where that money is coming from. But it's some people who decided to go ahead with the project, the Parikar, the cabinet, the central government, everything. We said, we have got the NGT under our control. We have got these people under our control. Who's going to be able to stop us? And two fellows went, and they don't have any money. If you look at the condition of Abhijit Prabhudesai, and you look at the condition of the other guy who I'm from,
Hanuman,
if you look at them on the street, you would not even recognize them, because you know they don't have a fancy car. I don't think they drive even a vehicle. They don't probably drive a motorcycle. But they have stopped a project worth 1,900 crore because they didn't do it. Now, what would be the consequence for Goa if everybody in this audience got into the air? Would they be allowed to do the things that they are doing today, making fools of you all, by doing the type of things that they are doing? And as I said, not just on April Fool Day, but every day of the year, no protests whatsoever, no rebellion from the public saying that we are taking us for a ride. You take the mining case alone. The mining case from 2004 to 2012, we calculated what is the amount that the mining companies earned in that period. The total turnover in just 8 years was 83,000 crores. 83,000 crores. That's from 2004 to 2012. You know how much we got? We got 2,380 crores. 2,380 crores. That is less than 5% of the value of the ore, when we should have got 100%. And yet when we ask people to come and join us, to go and crash these guys and say, what the hell are you doing with the resources that belong to everybody in this society and not just to Fomentos and Salgaonkars and whatever it is, we couldn't get people. I mean, Rahul Basu used to have meetings, we went to schools and colleges and we went to parishes and we went to all sorts of places. We tried to recruit the church, we tried to, you know, whenever people would ask us to come and talk, we would go and talk, we tell them, look, this is the status. If you had got, this is what were we due? You were due 53,000 crores out of that 87,000 crores. 83,000 crores, there was 30,000 crores was debited because of the expenses. But 53,000 crores was what was due to the Goa government, and the Goa government collected only less than 3,000 crores. So the result is, you got less than 5%. Now, if that money had been taken and put into the proper place, put into a proper, for example, into a permanent fund, 53,000 crores, every family in Goa would have been richer by 14 lakhs. Every individual would have got something like 3.5 or 3.6 lakhs. And every family would have got 14 lakhs. As per the NSO survey, the Goan assets in every Goan family average is just 10 lakhs. But 14 lakhs was their due from the amount that was taken out of their hands without their even knowing, and taken by Vedanta and Fomentos, the owners of Siddhartha Goa, and all these racketeers, and put into accounts. As a matter of fact, when the special investigation team went to seize their accounts, they found that all the accounts, they were less than 500 rupees. All the money had already been transferred to Singapore. Debt is a serious thing because debt creates instability, puts pressure on people, puts pressure on economies, make them do unwise things, leads to weaponization, creates, you know, military strife, increases the arms industry. There are a whole lot of consequences if you don't do things properly with the money that you are supposed to have. But if we keep on perpetuating this type of economic, you know, overlordship, oligopoly, you could say, between in the way this capital is taken by people, then today we may feel ourselves a little bit comfortable. But I don't think it will be, as you see, climate change is going to hit everybody. Whether you are in the top 1% or you are in the bottom, you know, 500%, you are going to get hit. The closer you build your bungalow to the sea, you are going to get hit first. It's going to hit everybody. Whether you are going to get overheated, or you are going to get chilled, or you are going to not have food on your table, it's going to hit everybody. So the climate doesn't distinguish, you know, between people. Some people may be able to protect themselves, like the British went to Shimla and Mussoorie and all these places. But by and large, everybody is going to get hit. And we have to take some sort of an urgent attention in that. And I would say, as I said, I came to the expectation for this sharing to see whether we can get more people to look at these concerns apart from making money. Money is a decent thing. I'm not saying that you don't make money, you don't do a job, you don't get involved. These are things I'm not holding any values at all at the moment. But some people are doing something, some people are not doing, some people are activists, some people are not activists. I said fundamentally, everybody who goes to vote is an activist. Everybody who takes a decision on the candidate is an activist. He's taking a decision. Whether he votes for Nota is very important. You don't like the candidates, tell them all go to hell. But at least do a Nota. None of the above. This is the only constitution, the only country in the world which allows you to say, I don't care a damn for even 15 of you, go to hell. None of you is worthy of representing. Maybe one day the proportion of notas will come up to more than the percentage when we'll have to have a fresh election and we'll be able to put sensible people in. But if you can't do that, there are so many other things that you can do. And there are the whole concept of volunteering now is only reduced to people working, volunteering with animal shelter. I find that my wife is always getting all the volunteers and I don't get anybody. Maybe I should run animal shelter myself. But we need people who have got brains, who can utilize these brains, who can digest data, who can put things, who can write letters. People say, what is the use of writing letters? I gave them an example. There is a road that is between Mapsa to Kalangut. There is a road. And a friend of mine, Samir Padnekar, he lives there. He has got a plot of land which he got as a tenant, I mean a tenant's land. One day he came to me and said, sir, they have put mud. I said, what they have put mud? He said, PWD has put mud because they want to increase the size of the road. So I said, that is your land, your tenanted land. Have you asked your permission? He said, no, they didn't ask. They just came and dumped it. So we drafted a letter and put it in the PWD. He said, who has come and put this mud here? So the PWD immediately woke up and they came. They said, we are coming for a site inspection. They came for a site inspection. They said, we have not put this mud. Maybe they are saying it because they were confronted and they found. But I mean, who is going to put mud to increase the size of the road except the PWD? But anyway, they got jolted. And now he said, you give me the report and please remove this mud. Why? Because in this country, private property is still highly valued. Nobody can take even one square meter of your land without using the Land Acquisition Act. Using the Land Acquisition Act is impossible today. The last Land Acquisition Act 2013 is so difficult, you require a PhD to be able to go through the process. So land will never be acquired. So don't allow anybody to take your land. So I'm not giving you the land. Take it out. So he wrote a letter, he got relief. There are so many other people who write simple letters at a particular time. If they had people to help, they don't understand. Many of the people who are fighting these battles, they don't understand English. They can't write in English. But they know their problem. If only they could be given some help, you come to an office. I've been trying to persuade many of my friends. Somebody has given us a free office, an Aadhaar office in Panjim. So turn it into a public center. Let 2-3 people volunteer, come there. Anybody who is a peasant, who is a farmer, who is a worker, who doesn't know, you know what to do with this problem, let him come there. Guide him. May 100,000 monkey wrenches bloom in this place, otherwise it's going to the dogs. You have to do it. You've got to stop everything. How do you think people are going around now blocking trees from being cut? I never knew that this is there. The Green Brigade WhatsApp. You put your tree there and people come to the site and they make a big noise. And then they say, how you are cutting this tree? Who gave you this permission to cut the tree? So the person who thought he could cut the tree now is alarmed. He says, oh, there are too many people watching what I am doing. So everywhere, simple acts are having those consequences. And Goa is a very small place. I mean, you can always rustle up. And if you say that I am going to go, if I am given a call, I am going to go somewhere in 10 minutes because somebody needs my help, you will create a shindig. The one thing that the politicians don't want is 5 people coming to the office because they think, oh, the voters are going to be against me. 5 people I've seen. 5 people go to the office of the minister and say, what is this you are doing? And he's automatically all oily and butterly and he said, this I never intended, this was never. Then they went to, they were putting a road on Kalangut beach. All across the beach, so that once the road is put, they start putting buildings behind the road. And that Sean Gracious, who is, you know, sarpanch. Totally ungracious sarpanch or whatever it is of Kalangut, he's a punch from there. And he said, no, I don't know who is putting this road. So imagine. This is what you call April Fool jokes. He's a punch, he's a sarpanch. He says, I don't know who's putting up a 3-meter road in the Kalangut beach right in front of everybody. He says, I don't know. So what these people in Kalangut did, they were a big constituency, Kalangut constituency, they went there and they said, we'll remove this bloody road. And they started digging. Then he said, no, we'll remove. Why you are removing? I am the sarpanch, I will get it removed. Then he got it removed. When the Baga Hill was being destroyed, and there was a bulldozer there burning all the trees and trying to create a road for Anand Bose, the fellow who has already ruined the whole of the Sankwal Plateau, the son-in-law of Somnath Zwarkar, who was a former editor. And he has come to, he wants to put up a big, you know, condo there on top of the Baga Hill. So here's their new April Fool joke. So they say, Mr. Michael Rover says, I am the chairman of the Panjim and Mapsa Planning and Development Authority. And we want to put a Jesus statue there because I have been to Brazil and I found a statue of Jesus there on the top. So we want to put, now this is the first time a devil is trying to hide under a bloody saint. He said, put up a Jesus statue there. Now for the Jesus statue, we want a road, 10 meter road to go up. Now when he writes to all the people who own the land, he tells them, give us the NOC, no? Because once you give us the NOC and we are constructing the road, you will get the benefit of 10 meter road, which is to put up a commercial structure of 7 floors high. So fortunately, the villagers saw through him. And they went there and they blocked the bulldozer and they stopped the burning of the trees. They filed complaints. They did all sorts of nuisances. With the result, everything has come to a halt. The para farmers have become legendary now. Most of them, you know, have some chickens and some this or whatever. They found that they were putting the electricity lines across their fields. So they said that every time you put an electricity line across the field, just to grout these lines, you have to put cement in the fields and these wires, and after that, no tractor comes to plow the fields. Because they said, how can we go through all this maze? So they said that we are there. So they came to us. So we advised them what to do. He said, you just tell them that who has given you permission under the Electricity Act. Under the Electricity Act, you have got to get the permission and the consent of the landowners to put a wire across. So they wrote a simple letter to the electrical engineer that stopped everything. Now they are chasing them. The electrical engineers are chasing them, saying that, please, why don't you come for a discussion? We will do it. We will do some other alternative thing. We will do this. We will do that. Whatever. The MLA is Michael Lobo. He is also discussing with the villagers because he wants a line because of all the developments coming up in Baga. So they want to supply electricity there. I don't know whether he is involved or not. But his wife is the sarpanch of the village. And the village people have got on her to say that she will not give permission. They have created a domestic conflict there. The husband wants the line. The wife says that as per the panchayat resolution, Gram Sabha resolution, I am supposed to lead the village to the site if they come to the site. If the electrical engineers come to raise the files, I am supposed to leave. But anyway, now they went to the High Court. The High Court said, you go to the collector and let the collector dis. Collector said, the elections are there. Let me first finish the election, then we will see about it. So this is just simple actions of people using the law to show that they are not fools. That they can do things. That this is still one of the only countries which still follows the rule of law if the person who is affected stands up. If he doesn't stand up, then nothing you can do about it. I just was thinking when I was coming here, the famous example of Jesus Christ. one fellow sells him out for 12 pieces of silver or whatever it is.
30.
And the other fellows, after he is hung on the cross, the other fellows all disappear. Peter, Paul, no, Paul was not there, Peter, all these guys, all disappear because they are worried that if they are found, they also may be bamboozled and put on the cross and finished up. And it takes some time for them to figure out that, okay, he has come back, so we can now come out and say that, okay, we are his disciples. But I'm saying, you have to think of similar situation every time. Why are people so timid? Say, I don't want to get into trouble. I don't want to do this. 5-6 of you people in the village can get together. If you are educated, you got a watch on your hand, people will respect you. You don't have a watch, they will not respect you. Put a watch and go and say that, you know, what is all this that you are doing? I mean, most of our village people put a watch, not because they want to read the time, but because they want to show the officer that they are educated. So they go with a watch. The watch doesn't work most of the time. So this is what I would like, something of this particular, before I conclude, if something can be done as a group. I know Nilankur only organizes these talks every Monday and then forgets about them. But as a community of people who have come to listen to this particular presentation, I think that it would be very nice if we all get together. We try this very often, if they can get together and say that, I'm willing to give you 1 hour a week, I'm willing to give you 2 hours a week, I've got nothing else to do right now, I'm just swatting flies at home. I'll come and help you out. I've got some writing skills. We've got a computer, we've got tables, we've got a fan, we've got an AC also in the office, but we've got nobody to work. And on the other hand, we've got all these guys, Vijay Sardesai, Michael Lobo, this thing, that Kaunte, Pramod Savant, all these fellows who are just running along like a flock of chickens, headless chickens, but they are running amok and doing whatever, because right now there is no real leadership and everybody is doing whatever he wants. But this is the time when you have got to really block them and put a spanner in the works. And once they know that MOPA can be stopped and that coal pollution in Vasco can be stopped and that many other things can be stopped and people are forced to come around, then they will begin to think seriously about doing any project without consulting the population. The rules today are that the population has to be consulted. Population doesn't want to be consulted. They can be consulted. Every village can be consulted. Every Gram Sabha has to be consulted before doing a development plan. But no Gram Sabha till today wants to even try. So please try, do it. And before I conclude, let me give you my last famous Nasiruddin joke, which I always reserve for these occasions. Some of you may have heard it before. But it's an apt joke for the, you know, for the ending like this. This wise old man from Arabia, he had a donkey which he would send out to people who would hire the donkey. There was one guy who used to hire the donkey every time. And when they returned the donkey would always be beaten up, be always some teeth missing, or some braces, or whatever. So one day, Mullah Nasiruddin said, I'm not going to give the donkey to this guy anymore. Took a resolution. And promptly the next week, he saw this guy coming up the street. He said, he's coming to see. He's coming for the donkey. So he immediately took the donkey and tied it to the back of the house, where he couldn't be seen. So this man comes up, as usual, and said, Mullah, stands at the gate and looks at him. He said, Mullah, I need your donkey. I have some work to do. So the Mullah puts on a great look of thing on his face. Donkey! He says, the donkey, I sent the donkey to my cousin in the neighboring village 1 week ago. At that moment only this donkey starts braying behind. So the man looks at the mullah. And the mullah looks at him. He says, it's up to you whether you want to believe a wise man or a donkey. So with that, keeping you in suspense about whether you have listened to a wise man or a donkey, I take my leave. Thank you very much.